Welcome once again to The Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos. I'm a sociologist who's taught at John Jay College and Yeshiva University here in New York. Human beings are social animals. We need each other literally to survive, to flourish, to grow, to find meaning to life. The psychologist John Bowlby identified pathological responses when children have traumatic loss of attachments and relationships in their early childhood development. It often took the form of severe emotional detachment to others and themselves, an incapacity to be social, to love, and be intimate. And without that capacity, we're like the walking dead, soulless, emotionally empty, devoid of any real feeling. The human soul needs love, the love of others and of the self. It's the oxygen of our social and individual life and existence. For Dostoevsky, Freud, and other great thinkers, the greatest hell on earth was the suffering of being unable to love. Now, we humans also need places to meet, to congregate, to share, to discuss, to argue, to have fun, to protest, to organize, to know and feel that we matter. A place where we can learn to love ourselves and others. The ancient Greeks and Romans understood this very well. Athens had its agora, an acropolis, 3,000 years ago. Open-air markets of assembly and designated gathering places for Athenians to express themselves and their burgeoning democracy. In the ancient world of 2,000 years ago, none was as grand as the Forum of Rome. It was located in the main center of the city, its heart and soul, where commercial, religious, economic, political, legal, and social life largely took place. It lasted over 400 years until the fall of the empire. New York City is now blessed with its own new forum, the People's Forum, on 320 West 37th Street in Manhattan. It's been designed as a movement incubator for working class and marginalized communities to build unity across historic lines of division at home and abroad. It's an accessible educational and cultural space that nurtures the next generation of visionaries and organizers who believe that through collective action, a new world is possible. A world rooted in equity, justice, and human dignity. Collective study and action for our collective liberation. Our guest today on The Radical Imagination is the coordinator of international projects at the People's Forum. She was raised in Santo Domingo, migrated to New York with her mother at the age of 18, witnessing and living through the hardships of the working class and immigrant experience communities in both cities drove her to the fight for social and economic justice. She plans and produces international events at the forum, as well as facilitating the educational exchange between international delegations and activists in the United States. She is committed to internationalism, and her passion is developing the Global South's new role in this growing internationalist movement. Before joining the People's Forum, she participated in grassroots movements such as Occupy Wall Street, Espanol, and the 15M movement in Spain. Most recently, she held a leadership role at New York Communities for Change, where she led campaigns on housing, criminal justice, and working justice campaigns. Welcome, Renata Pumarol, to The Radical Imagination. Renata, it's great
Thank
to
you,
have
Jim.
You here.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. And I've been a participant. I've been to the forum. It's only, what, a year old? It's coming up
yes,
on a year old?
Yes, we are going to turn 1 year in September. But so far, in little less than a year, we've accomplished so much. We've had over 800 cultural and educational events, the majority of them which are free. For our working class communities here in New York. And we have over 8,000 people come through our space. So it's been a huge success so far.
It really has. And I've been around the block a few times here in New York and as an academic and activist and so on. And I must say, I've never really felt the place was quite like this. in all my journeys around the city. It's a very unique place. It's as you say, you do so many things. Mm-hmm. And I've already sat in a course with Stanley Aronowitz on the left, and he's going to be here next week on the show. I've attended Palestinian debate and mm-hmm. and invited Rabbi Weiss of Natura Carta to the show here, as well as when Tiffany Caban was there, I invited her on the show, as well as Alex Vitale, who was speaking with her. So it is a fabulous place. I can't believe 800 different groups and people.
800 events that we've had, and over 8,000 people that have come through our space. Right. And it's truly a special place, and you feel it the moment that you walk in. We have a cafe that we call the People's Cafe, where you can sit down, have a coffee. We have the People's Library, which has you know, books from various topics, definitely, mm-hmm. you know, some books that you might not find in your local library because, mm-hmm. you know, they've been deemed too radical. And it's a place where you can just sit down, read a book, have a cup of coffee, have a meeting, bond. But it's also a space that it's available for our working class communities and marginalized communities to take classes for free, to debate. And that's why we call it a movement incubator. And to also have cultural events, to express their cultures. And that's why we have events such as, you know, open mics. Mm-hmm. You know, where we let young people from New York City, working class communities, express themselves. So it's truly the moment you walk in, you can see that there's a lot of exciting things happening in this space.
We're going to show a short clip on it, and it'll give us a better idea as we see this clip. But no, you're absolutely right. You come in there, it's a very welcoming environment. You've got the cafe there, you've got places to sit. And there's no pressure, there's no, you know, sell here and stuff. Mm-hmm. But let's show the clip here. It's a short little clip on the People's Forum.
This is the People's Forum. This is a space that we created for everyone who's been left out, everyone who's been oppressed and exploited. For all of us to come together and collectively dream of what a new world can look like.
Here at the People's Forum, we believe and are committed to placing culture at the center of our work. And it's not something that is added as an accessory to movement, but is at the heart of movement. And so in order for us to move the minds and hearts of people, we need to be able to uplift the popular culture of our people.
As General Baker once said, our duty is to turn thinkers into fighters and fighters into thinkers. By asking questions, engaging in study, and practicing collectivity, together, we can build a community that is able to contend with mainstream ideas and actions that oppress us all in New York City and around the world.
The People's Forum makes affordable food from local ingredients, and we make them from scratch every day. We want people to break bread and talk. That's all.
Come through to the People's Forum.
So come through.
Come through and build and have fun.
Come through and have fun, mm-hmm. and resist,
yes.
and learn and so on. So tell us a little about your own background and how you came to the forum. And again, you're going to have a birthday September 1st. Not you literally, but the forum.
Space.
Perhaps the space will. And so give us a little idea. Give the audience a little idea how this all got started, how you became part of this, and what you, in fact, mm-hmm. do at the forum.
Sure. So I actually came to the People's Forum a few months after it had, the project started, had inaugurated. I remember being connected. I was connected to folks from working in the Dominican movement here and like different fights. And I got connected through Claudia and Manolo. Started like looking, saw the space before it got opened.
So tell us a little Dominican movements, such as?
Such as, for example, we were really involved in the fight here against the denationalization of Dominicans of Haitian descent. So that's how I first met our directors, Claudia and Manolo. Mm-hmm. So I got to see the space, a group of activists, grassroots activists, got to see the space before it was opened, and we could see how special it could be, right? Like to have a space for working class, marginalized community to find unity in that space and to be allowed to learn, to take classes, maybe you didn't get a chance to explore themes that you maybe didn't get a chance to study in college, or maybe you never got to college and you're able to learn, to have discussions, but also to have cultural expressions. And being a member, it's also a member space where grassroots organizations that have very few resources can come to this space and have a meeting space, have a place where they can host their events, it turns, for like smaller organizations, it's a huge cost. And so it allows grassroots organizations that have very little money or no money at all to really thrive.
You said an awful lot there. going back to this idea of unity,
mm-hmm.
why is that so necessary? Why are different groups so oftentimes pitted against each other? And why is this, as you point out, so essential? Mm-hmm. To build unity in the diversity.
Of course. I think in our current society, many organizations are divided by issues. And like sometimes we cannot even, it's not that we're not even aligned, but we are not even coming together to see how we can work together in certain aspects. So, that you have perhaps organizations that are solely focused on education and you have other organizations that are solely focused on, housing. This is mm-hmm. this is a space where we can bring all of those organizations
and show the
together.
Interconnections
exactly.
of the struggle.
Not only find interconnections, but also perhaps, join in watching a documentary about Kashmir, right? And learn about the fight for sovereignty in Kashmir, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or attend a book launch. Recently, for example, I took a class on the movement to end slavery. Mm-hmm. I'm an immigrant, so I don't know much of U.S. history. Mm-hmm. And I was allowed to, that allowed me to take that class to learn more about U.S. history.
At the People's Forum,
and to connect with other activists who I knew, but we rarely get the time to sit down in a class and have a chat.
That's another very important point, because everyone's so busy and we're
exactly.
into our own struggles and movements and organizing and so on, and so oftentimes we as activists feel rootless, and so we've tried to offer this show as a way of bringing people together as well under mm-hmm. transformation of society. So that is so important, so absolutely crucial,
mm-hmm.
and I'm so happy to hear that you're doing that. And again, the classes are usually what, several weeks, or it could be intensive. I noticed in this week, I mean, there are just so many things you're doing even this week.
Absolutely,
I was Spanish for Social Justice Summer Intensive Beginner Spanish course.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, now that's gonna be July 20th from 9 to 3. Tell us just, what is that about? Spanish for Social Justice Summer Intensive Beginner Spanish
right.
course.
So, for example, that class, which is part of, our amazing education team put together this class. And this is for activists that want to learn Spanish. And they can do so for free at the forum. We also have Arabic classes. We had Quechua.
So this is a one-day class that will enable?
This is an ongoing, class.
Okay.
So there are classes that are ongoing. There are classes that last 2 weeks or perhaps a week. Mm-hmm. And there are some classes that it might be just a one-day teaching. Mm-hmm. So it really depends. And I really invite your audience to just check our website, thepeoplesforum.org. And that is our most updated list of events of everything that, we have to offer.
Mm-hmm. Now, you are the coordinator for international events, and as I said in my opening there, your passion has been internationalism.
Yes.
You've already spoken about that too. You know, why is that so important? Tell us why that's so important for the movement for transforming America in the world. Why is it so important that we need
orientate
ourselves that way?
I think it's important because we live in, I think what it is now, one of the most powerful nations that have ever existed. The influence in the U.S., in the international realm, especially, I would say, in the global south, the effects that the U.S. has had in Latin America, in meddling with election and supporting coups, supporting dictators, right? Mm-hmm. We talk now about the immigrants that are coming in, but what you don't hear is what is the root causes,
exactly.
Right?
We've had Juan Gonzalez here and on the show and talking about his book, trying to explain that. But it you hardly ever hear what needs to be heard
exactly.
About why people are immigrating. And as you say,
exactly.
It's not just fiddling. It's just trying to control and dominate
right.
and exploit and so on. So right. you try to make connections with that.
Of course. We live, as many people say, as I say, in the belly of the beast, right? Mm-hmm. And I think there are responsibilities. It's, for me as an immigrant, for my community, but also you as citizens that care about living in a just world, in a fair society, is that we need to fight, we need to unite in with working class struggles around the world, right? So that the working class, for example, in the United States have more in common with the working class in Honduras, with the working class in India. And it's important that we see those connections. And I feel like in the United States, I think this is by design, you don't hear about internationalism. You don't even hear,
under this administration.
Exactly, especially. And it's even
opposite,
hard to get international news. So one of the things that I've been doing, and even to find real, real news, right?
Yeah, yeah.
One of my roles at the People's Forum has been to bring that internationalist lens to the People's Forum in hosting events that are educational and that are about creating connections with international struggles. So, for example, we hosted a teaching about Lula the reasons why Lula is
his daughter.
Yes,
right?
we had this his daughter Lurian. Lurian at in the space, and we've had also amazing guests speaking. We had actually the Lula's lawyer join us via Skype and explain the case, which
you
she
set
did
this
beautifully.
Up. You are the coordinator,
mm-hmm.
So you really this came out of your mind and creativity and
our team, yes,
your
our
team. Right? Okay, collective, but. Now, you also did something on Venezuela?
Yes, we...
Tell us a little about that. What are some of the issues that you tried to get across there that you normally don't get in the
that you do not get in the mainstream media? For example, we've hosted various events when the mainstream media was focusing on the so-called humanitarian aid and the attempted coup and focusing on... portraying this picture of Venezuela, that it's, where people are hungry, et cetera, without talking about the root causes. So, for example, one of the things that we've done is to host an event about sanctions and
right,
the effect of
right,
sanctions
right.
to the people of Venezuela, right? There was
right.
a report issued by Jeffrey Sachs and Mark Weisbrot.
That's Columbia.
Yes. Yeah. That said that over 40,000 Venezuelans have died because of sanctions. Sanctions and mean that, for example, someone who suffers from HIV cannot get medication. So those are the things that we need to talk about.
And you're pushing back at this exact moment to Trump's rhetoric about, again, saying to the squad there, go back to where you came from. Of course, they were here. They were but the point, and it, what he adds is to the crime-infested messes that you came from, which he's not, of course, in any way taking responsibility for the U.S. role in creating the very suffering that is bringing people to despair and forced migration. So this is an incredibly important message that you're trying to get across.
Yeah, of course. I think I also want to mention an excellent event that we had about on Honduras and the anniversary of the coup that was in the Obama era to Presidente Manuel Zelaya. We had actually Manuel Zelaya join us via Skype. We had over 80 people, many of them Honduras, discuss the situation, explain what happened, how the coup unfolded, and what has been the result. We talked about the problems that Honduras are facing right now, where you know there are systematic killings. You know, it's one of the now the highest
most violent
crime rate and homicides in I believe the world. So I think you know it's so these kind of spaces, it's so important to have at a time where you know we are only hearing from the news migrants without discussing the root causes of turmoil in these countries.
Are people from those areas living in America, are the communities that you're trying to reach from the Global South who are now here, do they know the story as well of what you're trying to get across? Are they aware, or or do they need also sort of a consciousness raising?
I think you know we can always we can always improve, and that's the great thing about this space that we have, you know, working class people that you know perhaps never got the opportunity to go through college, and then maybe we also have working class people that did go through college but you know did not come out with the consciousness of internationalism, of solidarity, of understanding capitalism and how it works, of understanding imperialism. And I think that's the beauty about the space, that you can connect all of these people from different backgrounds. I mean, I am attending classes, even though, you know, I work there, right? I just joined a class yesterday about imperialism. And
yes, I've noticed.
And
this.
You know, it's been a great class.
It's courses on Capital, Volume 2, Marx, and the course, July 18th, imperialism. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we have a little bit. We have a little bit of everything, and you know, we hope this is an open space, and we want working class people to come here and learn and raise their consciousness and come with an open mind.
How are you reaching out to those working class communities? How are you making your space known to them?
So I think it's about working with memberships that have a base. I think that's crucial.
Memberships meaning organizations within those communities.
Yeah. Exactly, organizations that
such
have
as
a base.
Who are some of the members?
So we have, for example, I could mention some of the groups that I work with, like Defend Democracy in Brazil, or Brado from the Brazilian community, but there's also Departamento 19 from that, you know, is organizing Honduran immigrants here. So those are some of the groups that we work with, and those groups have bases and that they bring here. We also do outreach, and the very, you know, through our social media, the classes itself, I think it's also a form of outreach, and a person may come for a class and, you know, get to know the space and sign up for other classes.
And tell other people about it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, although you have classes on Marxism, I think David Harvey is teaching a course and so on.
He taught a course, and actually now that course is available on podcast.
Right.
If you can look it up, the People's Forum.
Right.
It's an excellent podcast.
And it is, and of course I sat in a course with Stanley Aronowitz, who actually we've been on for 4 years. He was on the first show here at Radical Imagination with Cornel West. So we go a long way back, and he'll be here next week, and so he's offering courses as well on left formations and so on. But this is, I want to make this clear. It sounds like it's a very open, as you say, an open form. It's not rigidly rooted in any particular leftist ideology. Is that fair to say? Because as you know, the left is very good at sabotaging itself and forever at each other's throats and so on. So how do you maneuver and get the left from some putting on some of its own self-inflicted wounds. You know what I'm saying,
I think,
right?
Yeah. Yes, but I think that we are very clear in what we are, right? And you see that the minute that you come into the space, right? Mm-hmm. For example, we are a space that it's unapologetically anti-capitalist, anti-patriarchal, and of course we just talked about... Exactly, and we just talked about
or internationalist too, right?
Right, anti-fascist.
Okay. And those are the larger parameters.
Internationalist, yeah. Exactly. So I think that's the clear line that we uphold, and those are the values that we uphold.
But within that structure, those parameters, there's a wide diversity
of
voices and strategies and you know arguments, and so again, you're well. Versed in that, and you're open to those debates.
Yes. It's a space where there's also debates happening. Actually, you know, not everyone comes in and agrees, and there's very constructive debates that have happened in the space where people start not agreeing with each other, and then they end up convinced. And you know, we had a beautiful moment actually with an event with. A Sahrawi group where we talked about it was a teaching.
What was that?
It was a teaching on the Western Sahara, which is a territory occupied by Morocco, which not a lot of people know about it. So this is one of the things that you can go and learn at the space. And you know, we had a debate between one of our panelists and a participant, and you know, they were not agreeing with each other. By the end of the event, they were hugging, taking pictures with each other. Mm-hmm. And I think those are like an example of the beauty of the space and how we can debate, maybe not agree and move on, and maybe at the end shake hands and agree and change our minds.
Right, right. I know that I've tried to have at various times discussions on the Middle East here in this space. Just a couple of weeks ago, I had Susanna Heschel on with Rabbi Brian Walt, who was the Rabbis for Human Rights and so on, and an interesting discussion on their position now, which is especially with Brian. Has become very anti-Zionist, but still a believer that Israel can be true to its history and heritage and so on. So what I'm getting at here is I've attended a couple of the events on the Middle East. Mm-hmm. You know where I'm going on this, okay? and so I find it really interesting. In fact, I've had, as I think I mentioned to you before the show, I've had Rabbi Weiss on the show, who was. The head of Natura Carta, which is an ultra-Orthodox anti-Zionist organization. Militant, they've been doing this for decades. And they, of course, and you had some excellent Palestinian speakers as well. Now, okay, so here, as the coordinator of these sorts of events, I would love, would you be able to bring in, for example, members of the Israeli peace movement? Or women wage peace which is a group of Palestinian and Israeli women mm-hmm. who are involved in various actions mm-hmm. in the Holy Land there. I mean, in other words, it's difficult to, you want to have discussions and debates and dialogues and get people in there that are willing to talk to each other. And you're right, there's mm-hmm. some people that you can't, that they're so far polarized.
Right.
So how do you manage this in these different events that you're helping to organize, which are having mm-hmm. profound effects on the dialogue and the narrative? So you've got to be very careful, you and the group that's organizing yeah. this, right? How can you move the dialogue, the narrative forward mm-hmm. and not just have people in there who are in their echo chamber and agreeing and, you know, okay, mm-hmm. you get the point.
Right, I mean, I think this, you know, working with different organizations requires a lot of diplomacy. We mm-hmm. work with various groups, some of them which are politically aligned and some of them which are not politically aligned. And we make those decisions, right? And we are learning as we go. But, you know, we also have a very clear stand. For example, you know, the minute that you walk into the space, you see that it is a space that it's pro-Palestinian, right? So
does that mean that you won't entertain someone who is a Zionist of any form? There's many different forms. Would that be possible to have a debate with them?
I am not sure that I can answer that question okay. now. I think this is something that we are a collective space and we would have to make that decision together. But I think that this is a space also that gives a voice to the voiceless, right? We also are very clear of where we stand. Like I said, we are an anti-imperialist, anti-capitalist space, and, you know, and with these terms, you know, and for example, in this topic, we are pro-Palestinian, right? So, you know, this is something that.
But there are different factions within that movement too, isn't there? We can talk about that in all kinds of different locations.
I think what I was trying to say also with like giving a voice to the voiceless. Is that also like there are certain groups that have a voice in the mainstream media.
I see.
And we are prioritizing marginalized communities, marginalized voices. And, you know, like I said, I'm not equipped to give that answer. We are, I'm just one representative. We are a collective space. Mm-hmm. But I also know that we have a very clear line in, you know, a very clear purpose of giving a voice to the voiceless.
So you'd be reluctant to have opposing voices because to that perspective that you're attempting to open a space for, because they have their own space in a sense. But isn't it also about trying to get people to understand that their interests are similar,
mm-hmm.
that you know, that war is not doing anybody any good mm-hmm. here? I mean, is that part of the efforts to bring diverse people together who are.
And I think as organizers, this is where we have to be smart, right? Mm. Like, you know, I also come from a community organization and, you know, we organize in different working class communities, right? As organizers, as activists, we need to also be smart and, you know who we can have a discussion with, who is open to be moved, and who is not, right? There are people that, on all sorts of issues, we are never going to change their minds. There are people that we can certainly work with, right? Mm. And I think the main objective of the space, it's also to create unity within activists working on different issues also. Right? Mm-hmm. That to find that, for example, a Western activist from fighting for the sovereignty of Western Sahara mm-hmm. have a lot in common with the independence movement in Puerto Rico. So those are the lines that we are trying to mm-hmm. to connect.
I see. That makes sense. Mm-hmm. I understand. That makes a lot of sense and is very necessary.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So, again, in just this 1 week now, you're having such an incredible diversity of events. And I wonder if you'd like to just comment on some of these. I'm just reading from your flyer here. Middle Eastern Love, that's tonight, the 17th. We're taping this the 7th. Middle Eastern Love Songs, Chorus and Drumming Classes. Tomorrow, Book Talk, How America Became Capitalist. Mm-hmm. And you have the class on imperialism. Dance for the People. Mm-hmm. Spanish, of course. Screen Printing Workshop Series. Then a discussion of Marx's Volume 2, Capital. Then on the 20th Annual Summer School of Women's Activism. And it just goes on and on. Then there's films. Shirley Chisholm, there's one as an act of protest. So mm-hmm. so it's incredible, as you say. The forum is open, right? 9 a.m. till 10 p.m. I mean, it's...
Yes.
So it incorporates a lot of time and mm-hmm. and a lot of energy to plan all of this.
And yes, and I have to, I also want to acknowledge our members who are, some of these events are planned by our members, mm-hmm. are put together by our members. And some of them are produced by in-house, by the People's Forum. So it's really a collective work, and that's mm-hmm. that's why it's such a diverse, topics and activities that are happening at the forum.
Right, and they contact you and then you as a collectivity figure out, well, will this be part of our program here, mm-hmm. or a way that we can further our purposes and so people can feel free to contact you with different ideas and different things that they're
To be clear, are a membership organization, so mm-hmm. the space is available to plan events for our members. And we mm-hmm. have a process on how to become a member. They can check mm-hmm. our website and maybe contact our main line to find out how to go through that process. Mm-hmm. But it's the beauty of it. It's the fact that our members can be able to hold space for a meeting or plan a screening of a movie or have a dance lesson,
a painting. So,
you've
also been involved in criminal justice activities, right? I'm curious. I'm a mm-hmm. criminologist. Taught many years at John Jay, and so I was mm-hmm. active in various demonstrations and trials, and so. So, what was some of the work that you were doing there, and how have you tried to bring that into the forum?
Yeah, of course.
There are everyday headlines and
Of course. I mean, we are mourning the fact that the officer who killed Eric Garner is getting off the hook.
Is still on. He's getting overtime, and
of course,
his pay has been raised on overtime. So how does your space think about what it should do in response to that?
So I'm not sure that I can give an extensive response on that, but one of the things that I know our cultural team is hosting is Black August, and they're going to have a discussion around criminal justice, around mass incarceration, around police
brutality.
That's going to be in August? This is going to be in August. I think it's still being worked out. But
I'd like to go to that. Yeah,
of course. But these are some of the issues that affect our working class communities, especially our most marginalized communities. So, this is definitely a space where we can mm-hmm. have events to discuss our criminal justice system, to discuss police brutality.
And I attended one a month or so ago with Stephanie Caban and Alex Vital mm-hmm. and James Foreman, who've been very active, obviously, in that movement. Mm-hmm. I was going to ask you also about your experience with housing mm-hmm. projects, and also how you are thinking about responding to the crazy back and forth between the occupant of the White House and the squad here. How do you bring that into the space? What do you want to get people to see about that?
Right. You know, to be honest with you, we're not discussing that yet in our space. We are mainly focused on putting together educational and cultural events where people could learn about a variety of issues and struggles. So, you know, we're not focusing on like what's the hot
everyday
topic now in the media.
Right.
But, you know, you asked about housing. You know, we just had an event on housing yesterday. It was the history of the tenant movement, which was put together by one of our members. Mm-hmm. We consider that obviously an issue that affects our working class communities here in New York.
Affordable housing.
Right, with the housing
rent
crisis.
Rent control and so on.
Exactly.
So that's how you go about educating and raising consciousness, very importantly, and so on. Yeah. So you were in Occupy also?
I was a little bit involved with Occupy Wall Street and Espanol, and so.
What was that now? What was that about?
So that
what
was
your role?
That was just a collective, a group of mostly Latinx, and that's why they call it Occupy Wall Street Espanol, which met after the fall of Occupy to just like plan for May Day actions or organize with immigrant communities and assist immigrant communities. Mm-hmm. So that's a little bit of what we did. We got involved with different organizations as well.
Mm-hmm. So you have events and classes planned, but it also seems like this is such an ongoing process that things can get introduced as well, very spontaneously almost. So it involves, obviously, communities interacting with you, and it you've really created a forum here, a place, but it has to go both ways. It's not about you as a collective saying this is what we should be doing. You're attempting to be responsive, as you say, to the voices of the voiceless.
Of course, of course.
And so often these people feel so alienated that they never even get into members groups. So how do you reach out to people like that?
To people who you are saying are alienated?
Very, extremely, to the point where there's hardly any social organization that they are part of.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's a difficult task. I mean,
the homeless, for example.
Right. I think it's a difficult task. But interestingly enough, for example, we are in the middle of Midtown. Mm-hmm. There's where we are at, there's a lot of homeless people in that area who actually just
by Penn Station, right?
Right, who actually just happened to pass by the space
and
realize that it's there and use the
sort of like
the
Occupy.
Space.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
There.
A lot of things are just spontaneous. And some of the things we are actively working every day, I think it's a work in process, to outreach to those who are a little bit more disenfranchised. I think our society with people, with rent being so expensive, with people having to hold three jobs, it also becomes extremely difficult to be so involved in an organization. So I think our job is to, as a forum, is also to think of creative ways how to bring them here, how to bring them to the space. And it has to be through an educational and cultural program that is appealing to them.
Yeah.
And that's why, for example, we have cultural events that that are, for example, open mics or Raise Up or a punk show, right? That you don't necessarily, the people that are coming to these events are actually not necessarily people who are organized within a particular organization, right?
Organizing the unorganized.
Exactly. And also outreaching to schools. For example, we just had a really successful youth fair with over 300 high school students that came to the space, and they were able to organize events by themselves. So this is one of the ways that we also outreach to people who are not, who are, you, as you would say, a little bit more disenfranchised and not tied to an organization.
Are you connected to the Poor People's Campaign? Reverend Barber and the Poor People's Campaign, have they been in touch, or are you in touch with?
We have a lot of people in the collective who work with the Poor People's Campaign.
Mm-hmm. So you're reaching out more. In the few minutes we have left, again, I could tell your passion again is this internationalism with the Global South. And tell us a little more about your work in that and the successes you're having. Tell us a little personally, I mean, this means something to mm-hmm. you. This is at your soul here that you're trying to relate to. I can see it in your face. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is something that is so meaningful for you. So tell us some of the successes you've had here.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, for example, alone bringing people from different struggles of the Global South together, I think for me that's already a success. You know, like I said, connecting Western Saharan activists to Puerto Rican right. activists, but also, you know, connecting Brazilian folks, for example, with activists here who are fighting on, you know, on the Amazon or on LGBTQ mm-hmm. rights, right? Mm-hmm. We, for example, are a space where people from the Cancel Bolsonaro campaign mm-hmm. meet, right? And it's people who go from, you know, Brazilian immigrants who support Lula and who are advocating for his freedom mm-hmm. to environmental groups who are fighting yeah. for the Amazon.
Climate justice and so on.
Exactly.
How it impacts on working.
So I think already making those connections, to me, it's a huge success.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Building that unity.
Well, there's just so much that can happen at this space. It can only expand and grow given the needs and the, you know, the dysfunctionality of the political economic system.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your plans for the celebration of the first year? I mean, listen, you've grown, expanded, mm-hmm. it's an enormously energizing experience. I hope our audience, every member, will go down there, 320 West 37th.
Yes.
And experience it. The yes. prices are right. I mean, it's not like, you know, $9 Danishes and stuff. I mean, you go to the cafe. You know,
People's Cafe is affordable, cafe and most importantly, exactly. most of our events are free.
It is. And I must also mention, too, I remember just when I was traveling around hitchhiking, I ended up staying at a salon, it's a place where travelers could go. It was a bookstore in Paris, and the owner, Shakespeare and Company bookstore, mm-hmm. and the owner was the bastard great-great-grandson of Walt Whitman, took people in
mm.
and just opened the doors for discussion for people who are writers and so on. I worked there for a few weeks and so on. So this is the sort of place, what I'm trying to get at here, that's the feeling you get. This is a welcoming place. This is a place to go for a certain amount of emotional, intellectual, and physical shelter
mm-hmm.
and grow and develop. And it is unique for New York. I'm a lifetime New Yorker. I've been around all kinds of stuff. This is really terrific, and it's
a very
unique place. I just congratulate you so much on this.
And thank you
continued
so much.
Success in the struggle. And again, one last time, in the minute left, we have 30 seconds. How do we get hold of you and the People's Forum?
Yeah, sure. I think the best way is to go to peoplesforum.org online, and you can find out there all of our information and all of the events that we have scheduled.
Terrific.
Thank you so much for having me.
It was great.
Thank you. We hope to see you soon in the.
You will. You will. Thank you so much for watching us here on The Radical Imagination. This is Jim Vrettos saying goodbye. We'll see you next week on The Radical Imagination and at the People's Forum.